Good morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. Actually, the Lord made every day, didn't he? What's special about today? It was the first day of the week that our Savior rose from the grave. Or I should say, rose from the tomb. And because he did that, we have everything we have now in him. We have a hope. We have a foundation. And that's what it's all about, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And that's what we're going to start today. In our final message for today, we're starting Christmas early. When we have other pastors who are preaching, I have put together a five-message series about Christmas and different facets and details of it. And I'm going to give the first message this week, and then as we fill out the rest of our schedule, then the last message will be given to us on Christmas Day. And if the other pastors, when they're preaching, if they want to incorporate something Christmas, they can do that. They can do whatever the Lord puts on their heart to do. But we're going to start Christmas early. I figured if I can put my Christmas tree up, I can start preaching Christmas. Right? And hopefully here in the next week or two, we'll start hearing some Christmas songs in our music. We're going to begin today with a song. It's interesting. This song goes back to about 1840, 1850, somewhere around there. The man who wrote the music and the man who wrote the lyrics are two different men. They were friends. They had a partnership. And it's funny because the man who actually... This expression, by and by, was born out of an attitude. This gentleman would go up and down in his attitude. He'd go up and down in his demeanor. He had a conflict, a lot of conflict going on in his head. And so when he would ask, when his partner would ask him something, he would make some kind of statement, yeah, whatever, and by and by. And it was in that expression that the lyricist decided to write a song. You might not be good now, but you'll get better in the by and by. Well, that's what we all live for, is to be in that sweet moment in the by and by of our lives. And so that's what we're going to sing about, in the sweet by and by. That is bare and pain. it's all about, getting there, getting to that point, getting to that moment where we can find that peace, that inner peace that we have with Him. This next song lets us know that trying to get to that place is not always easy. It's not always easy trying to get to that place. In fact, it seems like every time we think we got to that place, we find out we got one more something to go through. One more issue to go through. One more than... But you know what? That's exactly what the devil is doing. He's trying to chip away what God has given us. He's trying to chip it away so that we give up. Well, let's try to sing this song. One More River. have the promised Holy Spirit right now. We have the promises of God.
Yes.
As He never leaves us. He never forsakes us. He never forgets that we are here. There's a lot of physical things that we think you're supposed to have right now that we weren't promised to have them yet. He gives us what we need. But the desires of our heart has not been promised to us in this life. They haven't been promised to us. And when people don't get it, they get upset with God and mad at God. He said He'd give us what we need now. And when we cross over to that river, when we cross that river, Psalm said He'll open up His hand and satisfy every human desire. We just have to wait. We have to be patient. We have to have faith. That's what it's all about. It's not about now. It's about what He's going to do for us in eternity. And that's why now we have to make a decision. Do we want this world? Do we want the things of this world? Do we want the pleasures of this world? Do we want all the fame and the fortunes of this world? Or are we content with right now just having Jesus? This song says, I'd rather have Jesus. Let's sing it.
Thank you.
Let's enter into worship. This is really a song about responding to God's love. How does God show us that He loves us? Anybody know? How does He show that? We know he gave His Son. We know that. But how does He show us now that He loves us? His presence. His presence. His Spirit in us.
Joy.
The peace. All the fruits of the Spirit. That's evidence that God loves us. Now how do we show that we love Him? By praising Him. By loving Him.
Amen.
By being obedient to Him.
Yes.
And this is what this song is saying. We're giving You the praise. We're giving You the glory. We're coming to You with thanksgiving, with a grateful heart. Yes. And Lord, I can't do anything that could ever match what You have done for me. The only thing I can really give You, I can empty myself out to You right now and show You how much I love You. That's all I can do. And you know what? That's exactly what worship is. Let's enter into worship. I love You so much.
Praises with a grateful heart. Each time I think of You, the praises fall.
Jesus, I love you so much.
said it enough. That should be almost every other thing you say out of our mouth. That's all about worship. Worship in Him. We'll call Lady Pyle to come forward with our answers.
Praise God. Praise God, praise God, praise God. We serve an awesome God, amen. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. It's funny how God works, right? You know, Brother Joey was on like, well, I don't know some of his songs, and you see how the Holy Spirit got hold of him. That's the God that we serve, right? If you guys are interested to get a ride, Thursdays, we need to help from 11 to 4. And on Saturdays, if people want to come and help us clean the church, it is from 1 to 2:30. Right? And we also have intercessory prayer here at Bread of Life from 12 to 4. And that's the time we give out the food. So if anybody who can cook meal, we have boxes of food here, and you can come and pick it up from 12 to 4 on Thursdays. And we have a lot of prayer requests. Keep our brothers and sisters in prayers. Pastor Jeff and Sister Diana and some of our church members will be traveling.
I've got some special prayer requests this morning. I was in Roberts working the other day. Someone told me that a mother had had an argument with her eldest son, and he grabbed the keys out of her hand late in the night with his high on drugs, ran out the door and jumped in the car. And his brother, younger brother, and the mom went out to stop him. He backed up with other brother like this. And they're in the hospital in critical condition. Please keep that family in prayer. They're going through it, you know. A lot of different things. There's others in worse shape than we are, but we need to just pray for them that God can touch them and heal their bodies and get some health, that kind of thing. Okay.
Yeah. And we also have Sister Judy. Keep her in prayer. She's in Winston-Salem and she's in the hospital. Please keep Sister Judy in prayer. And we also have our sister Patricia, and her husband just found out that he has colon cancer, so keep her in prayer. And keep Sister Dixie and her granddaughter in prayer as well. And but there's a lot of people going through a lot right now, mentally, physically, emotionally, and spiritually. So keep our brothers and sisters in prayer. And like I said, we have intercessory prayer here on Thursdays from 12 to 4. Or on Wednesdays, we have prayer here as well. And if you want to send us the prayer request, you can send it to any of those numbers up in the front. You can text it to the pastors. They can pass it along to the prayer warriors, so that we can be interceding and praying for them throughout the week. Okay? So, and that will be, I'll let Sister Kathleen for Holy Communion.
Hi, everybody. Good to see you, Miss Julie, last week while we were away. It was a successful trip to see Stan's older sisters. One is 86 and the other one is 92. So, you know, I highly advise people who have elderly people in their family to visit because you never know when you might not ever see them again, at least not on this earth. We might see them in heaven, but maybe not on this earth. So I highly recommend you visit your relatives. It's good for the soul when we enjoyed ourselves. Now, we're having communion this morning, and I'm going to read you where Jesus declares himself to be the bread of life. John, Chapter 6, and I'm going to begin with the 26th verse. Jesus answered them and said, "Most assuredly I say to you, you seek me, not because you saw the signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled." And he's speaking right after we had fed the 5,000, right? "Do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures the everlasting life, which the Son of Man will give you, because God the Father has set his seal on him." Then they said to him, "What shall we do that we may work the works of God?" And Jesus answered and said to them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him who he sent." Therefore they said to him, "What sign will you perform then, that we may see it and believe you? What work will you do?" "Our fathers ate the manna in the desert, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." Then Jesus said to them, "Most assuredly I say to you, Moses did not give you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven." He's speaking of himself, of course. "For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." Then they said to him, "Lord, give us this bread always." And Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. But I said to you that you have seen me, and yet you do not believe." Of course, he was speaking to the people of the 5,000 who were following him. Let's not be like those people just seeking after the food of the body, but the food of the Spirit. Pray over this bread that you receive it as it is the gift of life everlasting. Just as the word said, Jesus is the bread of life. In his precious name, amen.
This I
lift up,
love that we shed for all of us, so that this bread allows us with his spirit, his glory, his power. The cross, when he hit on the cross, shedding his blood and his body, we might have life today. In Jesus' name, receive that life, receive that glory, receive that anointing of the Spirit of God today. As we take this communion, Lord, in your name, let us be healed by my Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Christ.
Thank you. life, life everlasting. In Jesus' precious name, take and eat.
Father, if we take of this juice of potential blood that you shed upon the cross for each one of us, that may today, from this day forward, we walk in the glory of God, that through this it cleanses us from all unrighteousness. In Jesus' name, take you a drink in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Father, Lord, as we come to you this morning, Father, Lord, as we touch the bread, Father, Lord, of your blessings, Father, Lord, and so much joy, Father, Lord, that we give it to you, God, we give everything to you, Father, Lord, because you are good and you are great. Thank you, Father, Lord, for this day. Touch each and every one in here, Father, Lord, that again, you know, Father, Lord, you know us. We love you and we give you the glory and the honor. Use it, Father Lord. Use it in a mighty way, Father Lord. Your kingdom. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen, amen, amen. To God be the glory.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
We're singing them songs up there. They just, you know, I love you so much, Jesus. I love you so much. This morning, touch my heart as I sang that song. It just really hit me to my core. And I pray today that something I might say might make you look to him like I look to him. How much he means to me.
today. It means that to you. This morning for my spotlight, I was asking the Lord every week to know what you want me to say. He spoke these words to me. He said, situated. Situated. That word can mean many different things in our lives. Today is time to get things in our lives situated in order. We're not promised anymore days on this earth, I don't believe. But God is soon returning. I believe He's getting ready to change some things. If you see the world turning upside down right now on top of itself, we have to wonder what's going on. Things are happening. God is getting ready to return. We have to be ready. Are we situated in our lives today to receive Him? Are we in a place where we know who He is? That when them skies open up and He calls us home, will you be there? Will you make it? Will you be situated enough to say, Lord, receive me and go be with Him? We're not promised tomorrow. We're not even promised another breath. We need to think about that in our walk each day. We need to come out of the land not flowing with milk and honey. He is the land of milk and honey. He is the land of more. But yet, we stay in our destructive lives, in our places, away from God, refusing to listen to Him and to hear His voice. Why do we do that? Why do we walk in misery? In doubt? In pain? Because of our own self. We don't have to live like this, do we? Shouldn't life be wonderful? Shouldn't it be glorious? Shouldn't we walk in the peace of God? Christ is standing at the door, looking at each one of us waiting. He's making a call. Hey, I'm here. Do you hear me? He says. Do you hear my calling? Do you hear my anointing spirit that's speaking to you deep down in your heart, in your mind, and in your soul? Do you hear me? He says. But are we listening? In Hebrew, the word valor, meaning to be in a snare. We're snared by the world's enemy, the devil. This enemy wants to keep us from God. But yet God is standing at the door, waiting for us. The snare. He's trying to keep us from God. You may ask what kind of snares I'm talking about. I'll give you a few. This fowler is coming against the people of God, bringing division. He's dividing us from Him, God Himself. This fowler is the enemy trying to destroy us. Are we going to let it? Are we just going to lay down and die? God is not a God of death. God is a God of life. And with Him, we have eternal life. In heaven one day. So when He opens up that sky, oh, hallelujah, we're going to leave here in a glorious place. So when we sing that song, I love you, Jesus, so much. I love you so much, Jesus. Do you feel that way deep down in your heart and your soul? I promise you, you're going to go wrong. I promise you, more peace and love and joy that you've ever had. Just know Him as Lord and Savior. With this, we walk in our own selves and not in God's Word. You know, we listen to man. We listen to man on TV. We listen to the politicians trying to tell us how to live. They don't live by God's Word. The Bible says that man will lead you astray. So who are we to listen to? His holy word. This is our instruction manual for everything we need. It will lead us and guide us to His riches and His glory. We have a manual, we will read it. We have the book of life, we won't even ingest it. We won't even look to it for what our needs are. But yet He's sitting there saying to me, all you who are heavy laden, and I will give you what? Rest. When we look to Him, to find this rest we need, this peace that we don't have anymore. And take the worries away. We have strife hence. But God is always taking us down through there, trying to send the hills and the valleys. You get in the valley, you're looking up at the hill, I'll show up. What do the choo-choo train say? I think I can, I think I can. Then he starts saying, I know I can. He makes it to the top of the hill, he looks over. He says, great, I'm on top. But through every battle, we learn something about ourselves. God wants to show us. There's a little lily growing in the valley. That's Him. He's with us, no matter what we go through. He said, I'll take care of you. I'll send you through. Trust in me. I love you. All we have to keep is looking to Him. Looking to Him. Pressing toward the mark of Christ. Pressing toward the day of His return. So look to me. Look to me, he says. You might say about the destruction in your life that comes from not following God. You might say, well, why is he saying that? Well, just ask anyone out here that serves God with all their heart, all their soul, and all their being. The ones that put Him first daily. The ones who truly serve Him and know Him in their heart. Deep down inside. They will say, I am blessed. Just maybe you're here today to find out what you have lost. Maybe something in your life has took you down a different path. Maybe one day you knew Christ as Lord and Savior. Maybe you had repented of your sins when you were a child. But maybe today you need to come back to God. Maybe you need reassurance in your life. Maybe you need some hope back in your step. Maybe you need some joy and peace back in your mind. He's here. Maybe you took the wrong turn. Maybe something in your life has stuck you in a place you don't know how to get out of. Maybe in that web of the fowler, he has you caught up and you can't get out. So what is your snare and your fowler in your life today? Have you thought about it? What is holding you back from God and serving Him? Do you feel down and trodden? You can't get up? The lack of no matter what you do, you just can't get up? Maybe sickness or depression has come over you and you don't know what to do. Maybe you feel sick. Maybe you're mentally, your mind is just tormented. Something's going on, you don't know how to fix it. You can't get out of it. Maybe you're addicted to things. There's many things to be addicted to. Food, drugs, alcohol, sex. There's so many things in addiction that overtake our minds by the enemy's tactics to destroy us. And we don't even see it. But yet, God is here with us still. It's a big call on Him. Maybe you were hurt. Maybe someone hurt you really bad. And you can't seem to get it out. and you're hurt so bad you can't get over it, and you don't know what to do. He is here. I'm here to tell you a truth today. Jesus Christ loves you, and he died for you. And today, standing here, right here, in this place, ain't come. He's saying, come to me. He is speaking to you right here, right now. Let's pray right now for a moment. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, send your Holy Spirit to touch our hearts, touch our minds, touch our souls. But whatever is needed, Lord, in our lives, let us look to you and come to you with humble heart. In Jesus' name. I want to read a couple of scriptures here. Listen to this in Psalms 3 and 19. I'm sorry. Psalms 91, 1 through 4. I apologize. It said, he who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadows of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. For it is he who delivers you from the snare of the trapper and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with pinions, and under his wings you may seek refuge. His faithfulness is a shield and a bulwark. You will not be afraid nor terror by night, or of the arrows that fly by day. For the pestilence that stalks in darkness, or of the destruction that lays waste in the noontime. 1,000 may fall by your side, and 10,000 by your hand, but you shall not be, it shall not approach you. You will only look with your eyes and see the recompense of the wicked. This is talking about the ones who know Christ. God is trying to get us to see this. He says, hey, when you walk with me, you walk under my shelter. You walk under my protection. You walk in my glory. I go before you. I will recompense those that come against you. That's what God does for us. As we walk faithfully with him. Today the enemy is trying to destroy us. But we have to hold on. Maybe today you're falling away from Christ. Maybe today you need that shield and that buckler behind you. Maybe you need that one that's going to cover everything. That one's going to put his wings upon you and cover you from all the things and terrors of the world. That's awful. Habakkuk 3 and 19 says, God, the Lord my strength, he makes my feet like deer's. He makes me tied up on high places. The final blows, and us on top of it. The snare, the devil under us. And we've risen above, and we're on top of it with God. Isn't that the way to walk about it? Isn't that the way to be in life? Why aren't we down in the bottom when we can be on top? Out of it. Out of the snare of violent hands. Out of the devil's wicked ways. Walking in peace and joy with him. See here, he is our shelter when we go out in him. The word says, we in him. And him and us. That's a joint effort. It takes us to join him, and he joins us. When we reach out to him and say, Lord, I need you. Lord, help me. He is our refuge that we can trust with all our heart. He is the one. He is our deliverer in times of need from the traps of the Father, the enemy. In Him, we persevere with divine protection of God in our life, and we serve Him and put Him first. His divine hand is upon us to keep us, to steer us, to lead us, to help us. And under His wings of the Most High, we have refuge. We have a place we can hide. Thank you, Lord, from evil tactics of the enemy. It is by God's shield we are covered. You know what it is today? You know what you're covered by? It's the salvation of Jesus Christ today. See, once you have that shield on you, once you give your life back to Christ, and give your life to Christ when you don't know Him, He is your shield. He covers you from all things, and He keeps us. I wouldn't get up here a week, and many of us pastors would be here a week, to give you a word from God if we're not walking under the shield of God. He wants us to share it with you, that you too can walk in peace and joy in the life of Him, and not have the worries of this world, because they are but for a moment. They shall pass away. But the place we're going, yes, is so much more greater than we'll ever know. And that's it. That's it. Today, if you don't know Christ as Lord of your life, I pray right now that the Holy Spirit touch you. And by the end of the day, you look to something greater than yourself. And that's Jesus Christ. Amen. I love you. Thank you so much. Amen. Hope y'all got something out of this. It was wonderful to me when I studied it. I thought it was a great word for everyone. Because I know a lot of people probably have went to church with mom or dad or grandma or aunt or uncle when they were gone. Maybe they've fallen away from God. And I feel like He's trying to tell us, hey, come back. Come back to your first love, me. And I'll send you through. Today, He's standing waiting for you to reach out to Him. He loves you so much. Amen.
There's a lot of titles for Jesus Christ found in the Word. In fact, I have a book that I make my own personal notes in. And there's actually, in all 66 books of the Bible, either directly or indirectly, there is a title conferred to Jesus Christ. One of those titles is a title that He was referred to in the book of Revelation. And that title is Daystar. We're going to sing this song before we open with our message. Daystar. Thank you. I lift up this word. Although we have heard this story, we've read this story, we've perhaps known this story our whole life, your word is alive and it exerts power. There's something new in it for us here today.
Yeah.
And I'm praying, Father, that you will speak loud and clear to us. I pray, Father, for your anointing of your Holy Spirit. And I pray, Father, that someone will be moved by what they hear. May your words shine louder, speak louder. May our ears be attuned to what you say. In Jesus' name, amen. This little Christmas series that I put together is entitled The Journey. The Journey. And I'm going to tell you how I got inspired by it. If you look at your bulletin, look at the front cover. My children know what this little picture is. Mama, show Gracie who that is. Does that look familiar? There's a little children's movie that came out a couple of years ago called The Star. And it is the nativity story, the story of Jesus' birth in the eyes of the animals. Now, the animals that were there. And so this little cartoon inspired me to put together a series. I'm going to allow my wife to play a clip. And as you hear this clip, look at this picture that's on the front of your book. One of these days, maybe we'll have a video screen and we can actually watch the video.
Don't think I don't see you, little ones. I think there's enough for both of us, though.
This is Mary speaking. What's this? She's just the kind of girl you would expect God to choose to be the mother of Jesus. And then we're also introduced to an angel, a blaze of light, a powerful creature, a little scary, but still a force for God. And he had a message of hope. In Luke chapter 1, verses 30 to 33, we read what the angel said. He said, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. Behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom there will be no end. Now this one incident, this angel appearing to Mary, set in a motion. It set in a journey. A journey that was going to change the entire world. A journey that would take Joseph and Mary to a little town called Bethlehem. And there the Christ child will be born, and the heavenly star will appear. And the shepherds and eventually the wise men would come and worship. This journey of Mary and Joseph would be a journey towards hope. And that is the title of this message today. Hope's Journey. Now, sometimes we Christians don't realize how significant that journey was for them. Because, well, that's all that has all taken place. It's already happened. Jesus has already been born. He's already lived, and he's already died, and he's already rose from the dead. All that happened before we were even born. But back then, none of that had happened yet. No one seemed to suspect how God was going to do what he was going to do. But it seemed that everybody knew for certain that God was going to send somebody. In fact, that fact was repeated all through the Old Testament. Somebody's coming. Somebody's coming. And when that somebody arrived, he was going to change their lives forever. The prophecies declared what that somebody would do and what he would say. And also were told to whom he was to be born. Did you notice how puzzled Mary was? How? Why was she so puzzled with the angel's message? Because she was told she was going to have a child and she had never slept with a man. She was a virgin. That was not supposed to happen. That was not the way things worked. But that was exactly what the prophecy in Isaiah 7 and 14 had said would occur. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel.
Yes, Lord.
But how could that happen? How could a virgin possibly give birth to a child? And when Mary asked that very obvious question, the angel replied, in verse 37, Luke 1:37, nothing will be impossible with God.
Yes.
That was her answer. So Mary was told that in spite of the fact she was a virgin, she was going to have a child. She gets all excited about it. Even the mouse in the movie is excited, runs out shouting, "Guys, you're never going to believe this." But now I understand people getting excited about the birth of a child, but why would anybody get excited about the birth of this child? What is it about this child that would justify anybody not only getting excited, but placing their hope in him? Well, it has to do with the things the angel said to Mary about this child. The first thing was in verse 32. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. The angel was simply echoing the promise of Isaiah 9, verse 7. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given. The government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end. On the throne of David and over his kingdom to establish it and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do. You see, this child that Mary was to bear was going to be a king. He was going to be our king. And his reign and his kingdom would last forever.
Yeah.
There would be no end. Now that's interesting. But what does this mean to us? Why should I care that Jesus was to be our king?
Amen.
I don't know if you've noticed it, but Americans are political people. Politics is in the news a lot these days. And everybody seems to be mad at everybody else. We tend to think that this is a new development in our days, but it's not. It's been like that ever since the beginning of our nation. I remember reading once about one of the House of Representatives went into the Senate and nearly beat one senator to death. Now, as bad as politics are today, we haven't gotten quite that far yet. My grandfather wasn't too excited about politicians in his day. He thought they caused more trouble than they were worth. But he had a solution to bad politicians. He said the most efficient form of government is a benevolent dictatorship. A benevolent dictatorship. Now, I think my grandfather would have been more than willing to volunteer for that job. Now, the word dictator has some baggage to it. It essentially means that the dictator makes all the decisions. He doesn't have to cater to a special interest group. He doesn't have to compromise with people he disagrees with. He doesn't have to settle for only part of what he wants done to get done. As a dictator, he simply speaks. And it happens. You got to admit, that's efficient, isn't it? My grandfather wasn't endorsing just any old dictator. He liked the idea of a benevolent dictator. Benevolent means that the person is kindly, compassionate, caring. Merriam's dictionary defines the word benevolent as someone who genuinely wishes other people well. Now that's how Scripture portrays Jesus. Jesus is a benevolent king. Jesus is a king that genuinely wants to help us. Hebrews 4:15 says this of Jesus. We do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who is in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. In other words, Jesus has been there and done that. God, who became flesh and had tasted of the harshness of the life that we live, he knows how hard it is to be who we are. He knows the struggles. He knows the frustrations. He knows the temptations we have in life. He has been tempted as we have, but he never sinned. And because he knows what our lives are like, we have a benevolent king who can sympathize with our weaknesses. So first, Jesus is our king. When we became Christians, he became our king. And he's a benevolent king who wants what is best for us. That's his primary objective for all of us. Secondly, the angel said in verse 32a, he will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. He will be called the Son of the Most High. Now, I'm going to venture off and go down a little rabbit path for just a moment. There's a doctrine that's in the church, in many of Protestant churches, but it originated with the Catholic Church, that Jesus has been the Son of God forever, for eternity. That's a doctrine. It's called the Sonship Doctrine. Their definition of the Trinity is for eternal Father, eternal Son, eternal Spirit. And that's how it's always been. Jesus has always been the Son of God. Do you know what Jesus was called before he became a human and came to the earth? Was he called the Son? He was called the Word. In fact, even in Paul's writings, it says the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. He was called the Word. We're going to read that in a few minutes. The Word became, didn't say the Son became flesh. The Word became flesh. He was called the Word. Did you know what was said by the angel? The angel told Mary, he will be called Son. Had he been called Son yet? Now, we know Jesus now is the Son of God, right? And he will now forever be the Son of God. But has he always been referred to as the Son of God? No. When did that become? When he came to earth, he took on an eternal title that he would have now for eternity. The Son. He will always now forever be the Son. But prior to his pre-human existence, that was not his title. Just a side trail. I just wanted to go down the side path there for a second. Why should all of this matter to us? It matters because it means he not only wants what is best for us, but Jesus has the power to make it happen. I want you to think about that. He is the Son of the Most High. This speaks to Jesus' divinity, to his being God. In fact, the phrase in Isaiah 9 that we read earlier declared that he is the mighty God. And one of the names for Jesus is Emmanuel. Emmanuel means God with us. When the Gospel of John started out, it describes Jesus, as I mentioned just a few moments ago, the Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. In verse 14 of John chapter 1, it says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. You see, the Word became flesh. The Word became the Son of the Most High. And that Word was God, God in the flesh. Jesus was God with us. And that's pretty much the consistent teaching throughout the New Testament. But here is the deal. Because Jesus is God in the flesh, he has the power to make difference in our life. And why is it important? It's important because now that Jesus has the power, you and me can relax. I don't have to sweat anything. Jesus has the power to do whatever needs to be done in my life, in your life. That doesn't mean that he necessarily will do everything I want him to do. But he will do what needs to be done in my life and your life. I know that as long as I live on this earth, bad things are going to happen. Nothing I have on this earth is going to last. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6, verse 19, do not lay up for yourself treasures on the earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. Everything I call my own is going to rust, it's going to decay, it's going to get lost, or it's going to get stolen, or it might die. And I know that while I live on this earth, I'm going to get hurt. I'm going to get sick. Unless Jesus comes first, I'm even going to die. And you're going to die too. But even in the midst of the harshest things that can happen to me in this life, I know that Jesus will be there with me. He'll never leave me. He'll never forsake me. And when I die, I know He'll carry me safely over to the other side where I can be with Him for eternity. Paul wrote in Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can handle all things through Christ who gives me strength. And you know how I know when I'm doing it on my own? Because that's when I get overwhelmed and I start getting burned out. When I start getting all burnt out and getting a bad attitude, it happens. And it's because I'm doing it, I'm trying to handle it myself. But as long as He's handling it, I'm relying on His strength and I'm able to press through it. I'm able to move on. I'm able to continue on. Yes, Jesus gives me the power to live life through my faith. And He does the very same thing for you. He gives us the power, I'm going to say that again, to live life through our faith. About 100 years before Jesus was born, there was a man named Yachovitz. He was a famous inventor and a mathematician. And he once said this, he said, give me a place to stand and a lever long enough, God will move this world. And he was right. He was stating an insight that physics teachers have taught students for centuries. But Archimedes was right about this spiritually, not physically. The place that we stand is Jesus. And the lever that moves the world is our faith in Him. One person observed this. Faith is the link that binds our weaknesses to His power. Lastly, the angel said to Mary in verse 31, Luke 1:31, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. This is perhaps the most important thing that Gabriel told her that day. Do you know what the name Jesus means? It means Savior. That's what it means. Savior. Amen. But what He's going to save us from? Our sin. The Gospel of Matthew tells us that a little later. When Gabriel visited Joseph, Joseph is told that Mary's going to have a child. And the angel told him in Matthew 1:21, you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. A lot of people look at Christmas as the most important season of the year. I read recently that merchants make over 60% of their yearly incomes from Christmas sales. And people, especially merchants, count the days until Christmas comes. In fact, I think there was one year I saw at Walmart, only 365 days until Christmas. And as soon as Christmas was over, they put the sign up. There's a lot of festive excitement that surrounds December the 25th. Everybody decorates their homes. The city puts up lights everywhere. Sometimes they have parades. There's a comic strip called Family Circus. Remember that? It really looks to life through the eyes of faith, through the eyes of children, what children see, the things that deal with life and faith, what children see it. In one of their comic strips, a five-year-old girl named Dolly holds up the baby Jesus from the nativity scene, and she declares, here's the Star of Bethlehem. But in the next clip, right next to it, Dolly's mother is holding up a crucifix. You know what a crucifix is? It's a cross that she still has Jesus on. And Dolly looks at her mom and says, I like seeing Jesus in the manger better. Why do you think she would rather see Jesus in a manger than on the cross. Why would Dolly prefer that the child be in that manger? Well, it's because babies in their cribs are cuddly and innocent and approachable. But Jesus on the cross, that's not so much the case. On the cross, we have nothing but sorrow and pain and loneliness. That doesn't appeal much to children. It doesn't much appeal to us either, does it? But that is why Jesus came to begin with. Without the cross, the manger is just a cute little story with no real hope. Without the cross, there's no forgiveness of sin. Several years ago, I visited someone who told me that it was hard for them to believe that God had them. You ever felt that way? They said they messed up so much and sinned so much in their life that they couldn't imagine Jesus wanting them. I can identify with that. There's been times that I myself, maybe in the kitchen or in the shower, remember something I said or something I did or something I thought, and it makes me feel bad about myself. And at that moment, the shame of the memory washes over me and I realize how stupid I was. Have you ever felt that way? We all have. But then the person I visited said that the one thing that gave them comfort was the knowledge that God had sent His Son to take all the sins away. God so loved them that He gave His only begotten Son so that their sins could actually be covered by Jesus' blood. It was a tangible thing that they could actually feel. That's why every Sunday in this church, we have communion. We take the cup, we take the bread, remind us of what Jesus did for us on the cross. Now, some folks never quite get it. They take of the emblems and it's just a religious thing that they do. It never hits home for them. But for the rest of us, the ones who understand how great a price God paid to remove our sins, we know that that bread represents the body of Christ that was broken for our sins. The cup represents the blood of Jesus that was shed to cover our sins. Now, there's preachers who don't like preaching about Christmas. They don't preach on the manger and the stories related to it because they think that Christmas thing distracts from the real message of Christ, the cross and the empty tomb. And they have a right to do that, but I think they've missed something. Two of the Gospels not only tell the story of the baby Jesus, but they spend a lot of time introducing us to people who worship Him. There are four chapters in the Gospels that dwell on Jesus' birth. Why? Why would God waste so much ink and paper on Jesus' birth? Because that's how God wanted to introduce Jesus to us. God wanted us to see Him as a baby, as someone who was helpless, vulnerable, but yet loving. Have you ever noticed what happens when the family brings a baby to church? What happens? Everybody flocks to the baby, right? Everybody wants to hold the baby, make cute little noises, and contort their faces to make the child smile or laugh. Everybody seems to make fools of themselves around little babies, right? Why? Because there's something comforting about a child. Babies aren't intimidating. They don't threaten us. They make us feel good about ourselves. That's the beauty of the Gospels telling of Mary giving birth to a baby boy. That's why the story of Jesus began with Him being a little baby. Because that baby in a manger, we begin seeing Jesus as someone who is gentle. Someone who would accept us as we are. And for centuries, that has been the message and the power of the manger. Oh, you thought there was only the message of the cross? Oh, no. There, too, is a message in the manger. I want to close with a true story. This is a true story. It's of a missionary team that was invited to Russia to teach Christianity. It was Christmas time. They taught the story of Jesus' birth at an orphanage. Everyone listened in amazement. None of these kids or staff had ever heard of the story of the birth of Jesus. Can you imagine that? Here in Russia, in an orphanage. So these missionaries are telling them the Christmas story for the first time, and they're just in amazement. And one of the missionaries, this is what they wrote. "We gave the children some materials and instructed them to create the manger scene that they had just heard about. All went well until I got to one table where little Misha sat." Misha was a little boy who looked to be about 6 years old, and he had finished his project. But the startled missionary saw not one, but two babies in the manger. Two. The missionary called for a translator to ask why. Why you put two babies in a manger? Looking at his completed manger scene, the child began to repeat the story until he came to the part where Mary put the baby Jesus in the manger. Then Misha started to ad-lib his own ending to the story. He said, "And when Mary laid the baby in the manger, Jesus looked at me and asked me if I have a place to stay. I told him, I have no mama. I have no papa. So I don't have any place to stay." Then Jesus told me I could come and stay with him. So I got into the manger. And then Jesus looked at me and he told me I could stay with him forever. Putting his hand over his face, Misha's head dropped at the table and his shoulders began to shake. And he began to sob. And he sobbed. But they were not tears of sadness. They were tears of joy. Because little Misha finally found someone who would never abandon him, who would never abuse him, who would never mistreat him. Someone who would stay with him forever. This is why when we finally put Jesus in this journey that we call life, we finally find hope. So many times we run from Jesus. We're scared of Jesus. We don't have anything to do with Jesus. All the Jesus people are crazy. But when we finally put him in our journey, we finally find hope. Our life becomes hope's journey. Is there anybody here today who needs hope? Praise God. Please come forward as the Lord directs you. I'm going to meet you at the communion table. let's have a little talk with Jesus. I'm going to say a prayer over our food for all those who raise their hands or for anyone else who wishes to come forward. We want to pray with you. A little orphan, 6 years old, heard that story and it was so real to him that he put himself in that manger with Jesus. And that's what Jesus is calling you right now. Come and get in the manger with me. Let's bow our heads. Father, we're so thankful for the message of hope. We love you, Father. We love you so much. We just pray in the name of Jesus, Father, that you will touch every soul here. As we approach this Christmas season, Father, I pray that this won't just be a time of festivities and partying and gift giving, but rather, Father, this will be a reflection of putting great attention to our Savior. As he, his word, became flesh, and he dwelt among us. He suffered, he died. He has offered us a new life. I pray, Father, that everyone here will find everything that Jesus represents in their life. I pray, Father, that Jesus will just open up the storehouses upon them. Open up their eyes spiritually. Open up their ears to hear his voice. I pray, Father, that in a hopeless world, in a hopeless time, that every soul here will find all the hope that they could ever imagine to find. We're not alone. This life is not all that there is. There is something greater beyond. And I pray, Father, that each and every one of us will know it, that we will respond to it, that we will walk in it. And I pray, Father, that each and every one of us will be there. We thank you for the food that's set before us and all the hands that prepared it. We thank you for your bountiful provision. We give you glory, honor, and praise. And Father, as you work in your spirit into the lives of those souls who are longing for more hope, I pray, Father, that they will come to the communion table and receive a touch from you. Giving you all glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Yes. was on there. Did you listen to the sermon today? Sometimes you just you have to let something go, you know?
Yeah.
And once you start making this cure yourself, to find the little work, the good things are going to be attracting. But if you keep settling and going back to the bad,
he said, I'll be back. I said, okay. He called me to work out. I said, well, how am I going to take care of two little kids? He didn't want me to work. How am I going to take care of two kids? You don't want me to work. Then I met this man.
Thank you. Thank you.